Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for coming out tonight to a very important double issue. Alan Mark is my name. I'm the chair of the Wise Response Society, one of the two organisations co-sponsoring this meeting tonight. The other co-sponsor is the Dunedin branch of the Young Engineers Association of New Zealand, and we welcome their co-sponsorship. You know from the program we have two main topics tonight, both related to mining. Unfortunately, one of our speakers on the Foulden Maar issue, Professor Daphne Lee, has been called away unexpectedly and urgently to a family situation. So Nic Rawlence, who's from the paleoecology lab in the zoology department, who has been collaborating with Dr. Daphne Lee on the Foulden Maar, as have many other scientists and locals, as we'll find out. Nic has offered to cover for Daphne and his own topic. So without further ado, I'll call on Nic Rawlence to address us.
Thank you. Right, can everyone hear me? No, it's all on. Right, is that better? Right, well, thank you for having me. Right, thank you for having me. So apologies from Daphne, who's been called away for a family sickness, but what I'm here to talk about tonight is basically what we're doing to help Save Foulden Maar as part of the Save Foulden Maar campaign, and to basically give you guys an insight into how important this actual site is to understand the whakapapa and the biological heritage of many of our unique flora and fauna in Tauranga. So just some technical stuff to start with is Foulden Maar is basically termed a conservat lagerstätten, which is a fancy German word for a certain type of lake and a certain type of deposit. But these deposits are really, really important, and there's a lot of the major advances in our understanding of how life evolved on Earth, where plants evolved from, where animals evolved from, how they changed through time. So like how horses went from tiny little miniature animals about this big to the giant horses we know today have been through the study of these exceptionally well-preserved fossil deposits. And so lagerstättens preserve quality rather than quantity. And so you get exquisite preservation like we've got down here in the bottom of fossil leaves. You can see the cell structure. You can get insects, fossil skeletons, but you can also get soft tissue details. So if a number of you have heard of the Schoenhofen deposit in Europe, as you get really, really nice preservation of ichthyosaurs with soft tissue impressions of their caudal fins and their tail fins. And so there's this really, really good detail available. So if we just look at these lagerstätten deposits that you find in the world after the extinction of the dinosaurs, so the past 65 million years, as you do see a few of them globally around. Thank you. Oh, that's good. Yep. So you do see a few of them globally around. You get quite a lot in the Eocene, and there might be some famous ones to the Green River Formation if you've ever been in a fossil shop and you see all the fossil fish for sale. The Messel Pit, which is the Northern Hemisphere UNESCO-protected equivalent of Foulden Maar, so that's where a lot of these exquisite bird fossils come out of, the really tiny miniature horses from the dawn of horse evolution. You get Riversleigh, which is a famous deposit in Australia, where you're actually getting a lot of these early marsupials, like Fangaroo and Thingaroo and other weird things. But in the Miocene, they're mostly found in the US. So Clark here is where famous leaf fossils come from, but Foulden Maar is the only one from the Miocene in the Southern Hemisphere, and it's here in New Zealand. So it's a fairly small site, but it does punch above its weight in the geological and climatic record that it contains, but also in what it preserves. So the important point to note is that it wasn't actually recognised as one of these Maar deposits that I'll go into until 2009. So this is one of the original geological sheets for Dunedin, and then you've got Foulden Hill here, and then Middlemarch is over here. And so if you look at a Foulden Maar at the moment, is you can kind of see the outlines of the deposit. So it goes around here, comes around through here. And so that's the old Maar Lake. You've got schist, Otago schist around here, but you've also got surface volcanics. And so it's about a kilometre across. And so just to show you some photos, is it's mostly farmland today. Here's your schist surrounding the Maar, and then the actual mining site, which was from the previous company that went into liquidation, is actually only about the size of two tennis courts and is only about 5 metres deep. So it's really quite small compared to what Plarman Resources is actually proposing to mine. And so initially, there have been a few discoveries done at this area, and there was low-scale and small-scale mining that once they had finished, they actually had to revegetate. And so in the early days, what Daphne Lee did is, with an excavator, dug out these pits, which are about 5 metres deep, and got to the diatomite fossil deposits. And what they discovered that ticked them off into knowing that there was something there is that when they actually look at the diatomite, is that there were these nice, really layers there. Okay, well, we're on to something. So Daphne managed to get a Marsden grant from the Royal Society of New Zealand for about $900,000 to study the site, and they used geophysical stuff that you see in Time Team. They had all the time to look underground, to look at the extent of the Maar Lake, and to work out the deepest part, and to get a core from this area, to find out how old it was and how far it went. So to give you an idea of what Maar Lakes are, is they're usually small, fairly small in diameter, about a kilometre across, and we've got some examples here. So this is in Queensland. They're usually fairly quite deep, about 200 metres or more. And so what actually happens is you, in this case, in Foulden Maar, is you've got basaltic magma. So this is the same type of magma that forms the organ pipes up on Mount Cargill, rising up through the ground. It meets water, and you get a really, really violent explosion like we've got up here. And what you end up with is this massive ice cream cone-shaped crater. It's like you've just basically dug a hole and shoved an ice cream cone in it. And the volcanic debris will all fall down around, and so you get this rim, and so you can't get any rivers or creeks flowing into this area. So this whole crater will fill up with groundwater or rainwater, so it's a completely closed system. And so what you get in Foulden Maar and a lot of these lakes is you get algae forming, and a lot of Maars actually have oil shale, so like the Messel pit in Germany's got oil shale. But the unique thing with Foulden Maar is you've got algae blooming in summer, and then in winter it'll fall down and to the bottom of these lakes, which about the bottom half is pretty anoxic. There's no oxygen. So if you're an animal that falls in or if you're a fish that goes too deep, you end up getting pickled and preserved really well. And so you get this really, really nice annual summer-winter layering of these deposits, and you get really, really exceptional preservation. So what they did with this first Marsden is they used geophysics, like in Time Team, worked out that the area was about a kilometre in diameter, worked out where the deepest part of this Maar Lake was, that they could actually do a core. The good thing for us is that is in smack bang in the middle of the lake. And so the core is about 200 metres in depth, and you've got the bottom of the lake here, so there's all the different layers going up through. All of this is volcanic debris, and then you get about 120,000 years of annual accumulation of sediment. And so it's this really, really rich climactic record preserved during this time period. And so to give you an idea, this just is looking at the core. So every single one of these layers is a different year. So you can count all of these layers, come up with 120,000 years. And most of it is made of dead algae. So this is diatoms. But you also get freshwater sponges, which are currently under study as well. And so this is actually recording like some of the first glaciations and melting of ice in Antarctica at the time. It can form what's happening in the tropics. And so it's really linking what's happening in New Zealand to the whole southern hemisphere in the world. But what you find with a lot of these deposits is because the bottom layers are really, really anoxic, there's no oxygen, they're being covered in this really, really fine sediment, is you get exquisite preservation. And so there are thousands and thousands of leaves that have been discovered in this deposit. So you can actually go there on field trips. You can find fossil leaves very, very easily. And so this is what they look like in the field. And to turn them from this into this, which these are basically slides between perspex that you can study, is about a week's work. And there's only about three people in New Zealand that can actually do this. So you can find a whole lot of leaves. You can actually get behavior. So these leaves have been nibbled by an insect. But you actually need something else to be able to tell what species it is. And the act of the preservation and the pickling allows you to get cell structure, put the leaves under the microscope and actually look at all the individual cells. And this allows you to identify the species. But it also gives you a whole lot more info. So we've got stomata, which are the little openings and leaves that allow oxygen in. So it can tell you the width of the opening, the number of stomata. It gives you really, really good indication of what was the temperature, what was the CO2 and oxygen levels through time, how did that change with climate change. You can also see trichomes, which are the hair bases on leaves. So we're not just telling what species of plants are around to reconstruct what this ancient prehistoric ecosystem was like, but we're actually getting a whole lot of really, really good climate information across a 120,000-year window 23 million years ago. And so, well, what can we find? So it's a world that's vastly, vastly different to today. I tend to call it a Miocene wonderland. And so what we've got here is a podocarp. So this is these leaves are actually about 30 centimetres long, unlike a lot of the podocarps you find today, which are only about that. And very, very similar to what you actually find in Queensland today. So we're talking about a real tropical rainforest that is living around this lake. We've also got cordylines. This is cabbage tree. So one of Daphne's students found this, brought it to her and said, well, I don't know what this is. And they looked at all the cell structure and actually worked out it's a member of the cabbage tree family. So we're finding out a lot of these iconic New Zealand plants and animals have actually been here for millions and millions and millions of years. And so this actually starts to challenge a lot of the preconceived notions and assumptions that we've had about the evolution of New Zealand wildlife. Supplejack, which is that lovely vine that I used to swing across cave systems as a kid in Golden Bay. You find a lot of it in the deposit and really, really good cell structure as well that allows you to identify stuff. But one of the biggest discoveries we've actually got is orchids from the site. Now, Daphne hasn't actually found any orchid flowers, but has got a whole lot of orchid leaves. Now, the big thing about this that makes it really, really cool outside the small bunch of orchid fanciers and horticulturalists is that there are only five known orchid fossils in the world, and two of them are from Foulden Maar. And so if we look at this whakapapa or family tree of orchids, you don't need to be able to remember or pronounce all of these Latin names, but these are where the fossils are placed within the family tree of orchids, and these are where the two Foulden Maar ones are. And so where they are here, but at where this group and this group diverge and this group and this group diverge, allow us to put what we call calibration points or tie points on when certain orchid species or members of the orchid family diverge? So when did this family diverge from this family? And so it allows you to really, really put a time frame on evolution of these unique plants and actually show how important New Zealand was in the evolution of this wildlife. But you do get flowers in this deposit. So this is actually the first fossil that Daphne Leone group found. They named it Foldinia, and it was a fossil flower, but it actually also had pollen still in the flower. And so this is an extinct group that is no longer around. So you get this exquisite, exquisite preservation. So the preservation we've seen and the information that you can see here is on par with what you can actually see in those famous Chinese bird fossils, where you can tell the colour of the feathers in the bird. You've also got all the feathers preserved. And so this is the New Zealand equivalent. But you actually start also getting a whole lot of genera that are endemic to New Zealand. So this is a plant that you now only find in tropical northern Queensland, but you also get up in Northland. So it's shown that Central Otago at the time was actually a vastly different world. But this is the same world that this famous St. Bathans fossil site is in. So there's giant lakes nearby. There's volcanoes going off. There'll be land crocodiles and moa walking around. And it may be that in the future that when we start exploring more of Foulden Maar, because what's been explored is this tiny little bit in the middle, it's the equivalent of saying we've taken two teaspoons from a 200-metre deep rugby field. And so if we start actually going and looking at other places, there's the chance that we could actually find some of these fossilised animals and plants as well. But we get a whole lot of different flowers from various species, and the preservation is really, really good. And so you can actually tell all the different genus and species, but what you're also getting is the preservation of the stuff that is actually really difficult to see. So in the top left-hand corner, it may look like a twig, but it's actually one of those species where the flowers come directly off the stems and off the branches. And so you're getting a really, really exquisite preservation. Now, as I said before, we're actually beginning to challenge a whole lot of the assumptions. So if you actually go look at the pollen in Foulden Maar, it is completely dominated by southern beech. And if you reconstructed the environment based on that, you would say it is a southern beech forest. But you don't actually find any southern beech leaves whatsoever. The leaves in this site are dominated by relatives of tawa. And so what we've actually got is a Laurasiate-dominated forest. There is beech forest nearby that is blowing pollen in. And so if we didn't actually have this really exquisite preservation, we'd actually be reconstructing what occurred wrong, but it would also have massive assumptions on how we interpret how New Zealand has actually changed over time. But it gets better. We've got fossilised squashed fruit from various species, some that are still around today, like on the left, some that have gone extinct, like on the right. But it's not just plants that we're finding, we're actually getting insects. And so before Daphne started the work, there were about five insect fossils known from New Zealand. Her team has now found 560-something fossils, and 266 or 67 are from Foulden Maar. And so the rate of discovery is still exponentially climbing. So every single 264 of those 266 insects are all different, except those two, which are basically left and right, or two individuals of the same species. And so the rate of discovery is just going through the roof. But what we're also getting is fossilised examples of behaviour. So that leaf that you can see up on the top right, all those white spots are actually scale insect. They're the things that you spray off your apple trees that you don't like. And they're all in life position on that leaf that's been preserved. But we're getting termite fossils, and termites are not that common in New Zealand, but they were before. So we've seen a whole lot of biological turnover as you've gone from this greenhouse subtropical world into the cooler ice ages and what you find now. Heaps and heaps of beetles, hundreds of beetles, but that's still to be looked at. We're still looking for students to actually study this, and there'll be lots and lots of new species and genera and endemic beetles and extinct ones, but you've also got exquisite preservation, and so the top middle photos, you actually start getting exquisite colour preserved. You can actually dig these fossils up. I've been to the site on many a field trip, and you can actually still see the colour preserved in a lot of these fossils. We get flies, so a lot of you will recognise these ones, which are flying around today, but that one in the bottom left doesn't actually look like much until you shove it under the microscope. And that photo in the bottom middle is actually its eyes. And then the one on the bottom right is the eyes of its closest living relatives. So you can actually start seeing everything in very exquisite detail. We've got lots and lots of ant fossils. There are about 11 orders of ants that are actually around the world today, and you find in New Zealand. But there are 11 fossil ants and different ants in this deposit. So a lot of what you're actually seeing now is a remnant of what actually used to be a much more diverse ecosystem. We also get spiders. There are 9 orders of spiders in the world, and Foulden Maar's actually got the vast majority of all of them as fossils. And so this has actually been worked up at the moment. But it's not just plants, it's not just invertebrates. You're also getting exquisite fossils like this one. And so this, Daphne was telling me, she went to the site, there was a famous freshwater fish biologist, Bob McDowell, yep, was going to turn up at the site, and they split open this just before Bob turned up and found that. He actually thought that Daphne was pranking him. But they've got over 200 fish fossils from the site now, and these are the oldest galaxids, so white, think white, adult white bait in the world, and they're from this site. But you're probably thinking, well, how do fish get into this closed system? And what you're actually finding is a lot of the water birds, kingfishers, herons, will actually pick up fish and they'll take them in and they'll drop them in all of these water systems. So these closed systems very, very quickly end up with freshwater fish. But it's not just fish, you're getting eels. And so you've got the oldest eel fossil in the world from Foulden Maar, and also a related site, Hindon Maar. And so it's fossils like these that we can actually start revolutionising what we know of the evolution of galaxids, of eels. We can start putting new tie points and family trees to say these things evolved in the Southern Hemisphere in New Zealand. New Zealand was important. Now, the important thing I'd like to note about Hindon Maar, where this fossil comes in, is Hindon Maar is about 15 minutes out of Outram. It's a whole series of 4 or 5 Maar lakes. They're about 15 million years old, so they're about 8 million years younger than Foulden Maar, but the preservation of the fossils is as exquisite or even more so than Foulden Maar, and it also includes bird feathers, I think is what Daphne's told me, is bird feathers as well. Now, Hindon Maar, the Hindon Maar complex is all calcium carbonate-rich clay. There's no diatomite in it, but Plarman Resources has an exploration permit for all Maars across Otago. And what Daphne was telling me is they just had a meeting with Craig Pilcher and the Geological Society, and Plarman was saying, well, we will give you the Hindon Maar complex if you let us destroy Foulden. And Daphne said, well, actually, no, we're not going to let you do that because we know Hindon is completely useless to you guys, so stop trying to fob us off. But what we're looking at basically is this tropical greenhouse world with a rainforest surrounding this lake. It would have been very steep sides going into the lake, but there would have been a lot of animals that we recognise, like cabbage trees and tawa and galaxids, but there will be a lot of really, really weird things that we don't recognise, as weird as some of the birds that you actually get coming out of the St. Bathans deposit. So, what would happen if Plarman Resources started mining here? So, this is the aerial shot of Foulden Maar that we were telling you about before. This is basically the area of the Maar that they want to mine, and they want to mine about 500 tons a year for 27 years, 24/7, Yes, a million tonnes a year, 500,000 processed. Because the thing you have to realise with diatomite is 60 to 80% of it is actually water. Now, that area just to the left of where the mine is would be a giant, massive spoil trash heap. Now, one of the issues is you've got diatomite is basically fossilised silica grains, so glass, I think really fine-scale fibreglass. That would be blowing around. So there's major occupational health and safety issues with this. Now, silica, if it's breathed in, actually causes silicosis, which is the equivalent of asbestosis, which isn't good. So that's going to be probably blowing around, but it's also going to be in all the trucks that will go from Foulden Maar down to Milton. And so that road is, if any of you have actually tried to drive along Western Australian or Queensland roads with all the mining trucks, it won't be fun. So after the mine, they're proposing to build a lake. Now, Plarman have said they will give us 5 hectares on the edge of the lake. Now, the problem is 5 hectares would erode into the lake. If you put the lake, then there's no science whatsoever. We need to preserve, if mining was going to go ahead, at least half the lake. You need to preserve the deepest part. So there is a core from Foulden Maar. But the core's about 10 years old, and no matter what we do, keeping it cold and the fridge, cores degrade. The preservation is much better if you get it fresh out of the ground. And so someone in the future with better technology will need to go and excavate fossils, need to get a core. And so we need, if mining did go ahead, we need to preserve at least half the deposit and the deepest part of it. The other issue is, if any of you read Farrah Hancock's article in Newsroom yesterday, where she was talking to the CEO of the mining company in Australia with the unpronounceable Greek name, is that they effectively threw a tantrum and basically said, well, if we don't get the OIO approval, we will just mine the 42 hectares that we own, which is that, and stuff you all. We'll do it all in its entirety. Is the 20% that would be protected in the land that they're trying to get the OIO doesn't actually preserve the deepest part of the deposit as well. But there's also another myth that the miners are pushing, is that they need to do the large-scale mining so that then we can get access to all of the deepest layers. Now, it's a half-truth. Mining does help. The small-scale mining that had been occurring up until very recently allowed access to the site. But if you think of having that ice cream cone in the ground and you have a whole lot of pieces of bread sitting on top, which are all your layers, and you try to push those layers down into the ice cream cone. So you'll push with your finger. And the middle will go down and the sides will just shoot up. They'll basically tilt. And so what that means is rather than being nice layers like that, you're getting layers like this. And so you don't actually need to do much excavation or dig deep or much, because you can get a nice stratigraphic sequence, say, going from left to right, which basically goes from young to old, very, very close to the surface. So, to sum up a few things, you are looking at basically the most important geological and fossil site in New Zealand. You're looking at the Southern Hemisphere equivalent of the Messel Pit, which was commercially owned. It was a mine at one stage. It was going to be turned into a rubbish dump at some stage, and the German province or state it's in bought it and turned it into a UNESCO World Heritage Site. And so you've got a 23-million-year-old Maar Lake that's filled up with a whole lot of diatomite over 120,000 years, and it gives a unique record of the ecosystem. It's the only known annually layered record of the earliest Miocene. So, as I said before, it's recording what's happening in Antarctica, in New Zealand, in the tropics, and is basically linking New Zealand to the world. There's a famous phrase by a biogeographer, Gareth Nelson, that said, explain New Zealand and the rest of the world falls into place around it. And this is true here. We can study individual years, so we can actually start looking at El Nino events, La Nina events, and how that's actually impacted. And we can start looking at the amount of CO2 and how that's influenced climate change with the the openings of the stomata and the number of them that you've got. We've got tens of thousands of preserved plants. We've got hundreds of known species, like to be thousands, and the discoveries are only exponentially increasing. And what it's actually doing is just proving this phrase in geology that the past is the key to the present and future. So the more we learn about this past and what New Zealand was like and how it changed, we can actually look at how New Zealand will respond in the future. So one of the things the mining company is saying, and it was actually quite ironic, because they're marketing this as Black Pearl, and on TV on Sunday night was Curse of the Black Pearl movie. So black diatomite versus white diatomite. White diatomite is the stuff in the bottom right picture that you can see just above the black. That is the weathered diatomite. Black diatomite is freshly dug up diatomite. And that's about 60 to 80% water. Within a few hours of it being dug up, it starts drying out. It loses all its water. It loses all its carbon. And you're left with a whole lot of silica granules. And you've gone to white diatomite. If you want to go mine white diatomite, there are plenty of other places in the world to go do it and not dig up this. But if any of you have also read Farrah Hancock's fantastic article where she was dispelling a lot of the so-called science that Plowman is pushing, that this is the next miracle stop feed that'll bulk up animals, we won't have to give them antibiotics. She has some fantastic quotes from various scientists, veterinary scientists in New Zealand, agricultural scientists in the US that have basically said there is no peer-reviewed research at all published. One said, well, I can't comment on it, there's nothing peer-reviewed. One went, yeah, good luck with that one to the mining company. And several others have basically debunked all of the claims. It can be basically put down to a food additive. It'd be like, I want to make baby formula last longer, so I'm going to bulk it out with corn flour. That is effectively what they are wanting to do. So I came into this basically, I was sitting at a conference at GNS the other week looking at all the Twitter feed of all the world going mad with the Moa footprint discovery, and then I read Farrah Hancock's article and I cheekily sent out a tweet and said, while Otago Museum and Otago Uni is busy saving Moa footprints, a Malaysian-Australian owned mining company with links to palm oil want to come destroy a premier fossil site in our backyard, and it went viral. Helen Clark then friended me and started messaging me. So we have her support. The reason we have her support is she can trace a lot of her family to Oamaru. She's also the patron of the North Otago Geopark, so this is very close to home for her. But a lot of this work wouldn't have been possible without what Andrew and Shane have been doing for the past year, that gave us all of the info that Farrah could do such a fantastic article, that all of this stuff could go viral. So we have a petition going. We can send you the info. It's all over Facebook and also all over Twitter. We've got about 8,500 signatures so far and climbing. We've sent open letters to the DCC. We've had meetings with Claire Curran, who has said that she may have had the wool pulled over her eyes, but at the same time she also said that it wasn't her fault, that she didn't do any due diligence to actually look at whether people who were telling her the truth or to dig any deeper. So what we're pushing is, ideally we would like Foulden Maar designated an outstanding geological feature under the Reserves Act. We would also like it as a scientific reserve, outstanding geological feature under the Resource Management Act. We'd like it as a scientific reserve under the Reserves Act, and that could be either the company realising that they're not actually going to make any money and the community opposition is far from being underfunded, undereducated and undermotivated. Or the government compulsorily acquire the land and let the family continue to farm and live on the land, because farming is not going to affect this, the fossils in this deposit as well. What the Geological Society of New Zealand has done is they've actually given it the highest classification for a geological feature in New Zealand. And so this would be like the geysers in Rotorua. It'd be the equivalent of the pyramids of Giza. So this is why we think it's quite ludicrous with Plama wanting to say, well, we'll give you Hindon if you let us destroy Foulden. That would be saying, well, we'll give you the pyramids if you let us destroy the Sistine Chapel. So basically, the university's invested in the Royal Society of New Zealand probably over $2 million already in research here with two Marsdens back-to-back. There's a huge international team of researchers from all around the world and plenty of students that have come through Daphne's lab in geology, but we could actually really turn this into a full-scale scientific reserve or a geological park where you can actually go with your kids, visit the site, students can go and do research. It's preserved in perpetuity. And so just some acknowledgements of the various people that have been working on the site. John Conran from University of Adelaide, Beth Fox, who's now back in the UK. We've got Dallas Mildenhall, who is one of the people that has actually been doing all of the fossil plant preparations, along with Jennifer Bannister. So, any questions?